we're looking at one of my favorite sculptures in the Bode-Museum collection. We see a seated figure of Jesus here with his young disciple John leaning on his breast. This was sculpted by an unknown artist, certainly an artist working around the area of Lake Constance at the very beginning of the 14th century. This intimate moment here is actually extracted from a much larger narrative. So more often we would see these two figures seated at a table at the Last Supper. John, as you can see here, has fallen asleep and is leaning his head against Jesus's breast. And Jesus has put one of his hands on John's shoulder and they're clasping their hands in a very tender, intimate sort of way here, in a way that might look quite homoerotic to some viewers.
John is described as the beloved disciple, so there's clearly a very special relationship between them. And I think the degree of trust that he seems to show in sleeping, we're told in John's Gospel that he rests on Jesus, but the rest is here taken all the way to what seems like sleep. So there's this absolute trust, and Jesus' face seems to have a certain kind of protective vigilance about it. And also there's something poignant about the fact that he, whilst himself vulnerable, this is towards the end of his life, is nevertheless communicating such a protective aura around this beloved friend as well as disciple of his.
And before this moment, there's a sequence of events that have led from the baptism, which we just looked at, that is John the Baptist's baptism of Jesus, a different John than we're looking at here. And then Christ takes up his ministry. He starts preaching, doesn't he? And he starts healing and he starts recruiting a group of disciples around him.
That's right. And that period is about 3 years long. I often think that Jesus' life, interestingly, can be divided into three sets of three. There are the 3 decades of his growing up from his birth up until that baptism when he goes public. And then 3 years of active ministry, which, as you say, are marked by teaching, healing, and so on. And then the final 3 days of his life, often called the Passion, between his arrest and eventual crucifixion. So here we have, if you like, the culmination of the 3 years that began with the baptism, which we looked at in our last film. One of the things that I especially love about the resting on Christ's breast is that it echoes the language that elsewhere the New Testament uses about intimacy with God. So to be close to God, even to be in heaven, is described as being in the bosom of the Father. Mm. So that sense of being drawn near to God is somehow captured through very physical human bodies here. It's at once very human and, at another level, a sort of divine human event, which of course is appropriate for this figure who is both divine and human. And the word resting in Greek, which is used a lot in the Gospel of John, can also mean abiding, so it has this stronger sense of almost a permanent home being created. And Jesus at the end of the Gospels talks about going to prepare many abiding places, many abodes in heaven for his disciples. So this moment of rest is almost like an anticipation of heaven and the heaven promised to all of his followers, not only this one beloved disciple, but everyone is welcomed into that belovedness and into that intimacy and that home.
This beautiful, intimate moment is actually extracted from a much larger narrative. So more often when we see these two figures together, they're seated at a table with the rest of the disciples in a scene that's known as the Last Supper. So I think to understand this object in context, we should go look at a representation of the Last Supper. Well, here in the Gemäldegalerie, we have the representation of Jesus and John the Evangelist asleep on his breast in the way that we saw in the sculpture in the Bode-Museum just now. But here you can see in this fragment of an altarpiece painted around the 1480s by an artist who is just known as the master of the house book. We don't know the true identity of this artist. That the two figures are now set into a much larger scene, and it's the scene of the Last Supper. And the moment represented is just before Jesus announces to all of his followers, to his disciples, that one of them will betray him. And he indicates that he's going to dip the morsel. As you can see here, he's dipping probably a piece of bread, it looks like, there beside the Easter lamb. And he's going to offer it to one of them. And he says the person he offers that morsel to, that will be the person who will betray him.
And that's Judas, of course, who we see here in the foreground fingering both what looks like a dagger and a money bag, both rather sinister associations. And the money bag is the money he's received for betraying Jesus. And even a little fly is watching, associated in this rather distasteful way with a rather distasteful act.
You'll notice he's the only one without a golden halo.
Oh, yes. This is also the event at which Jesus institutes, which is to say, establishes and commands his followers to continue the ritual of taking bread and wine as though they're his body and blood. And he promises that when that happens, his followers will receive him in some way personally. And so this is often called the institution of the Eucharist, which is the Christian ritual of remembering Christ, receiving Christ in bread and in wine. And that's something that would have been celebrated on every Christian altar all over the Christian world.
In this way, I think the representation of the table of the Last Supper is already suggesting an altar table. You'll notice that the wine that Christ is about to drink is in this chalice shape. That's what we expect to see on an altar during the celebration of the Mass.
And an altar is a place of sacrifice in many religions, of course. And it's the sacrifice of Jesus that we're going to look at in our next film.